Hi everyone, this is Shreya Broy, and you all know I'm a Chelsea fan, so here I'm going to bring my review of the Premier League season 2019 and 2020. So guys, we all know it's been a very amazing season. We all have enjoyed it. It's been like a fully roller coaster with its thrills, with all its surprises, with all the great outcomes. The first season, the first day started with Liverpool versus Norwich, where Liverpool thrashed Norwich 4-1. And we all were really excited to see how the season will go. We all knew from the last season, where we had a great title race, that Liverpool are the biggest contender to win it along with City. And the first day of the season just showed it what it's all capable of. So I think that raised our excitement. Chelsea had a new manager, Frank Lampard, a new youth project. United had some new signings. Arsenal had one of the best windows according to some people, and Tottenham, we all know they were going down, but because it's a Champions League final, there was certain excitement. It was also very good to see Sheffield United back in the league. So I think when we all would have predicted the season at the start, I think nobody would have thought that Sheffield United will be in the top 6 to top 7. We will never have predicted Wolves to have such a great season. We will never have predicted to see Leicester City do so well. And also, we will not have expected 66 points to be enough for top 4. So I think if we review the season, let's go from the bottom, Norwich City. So with Norwich City, the thing was, we all knew they were going to be relegated. There was never any doubt in our mind. So with Norwich City, see, they never even spent the money. They came from the championship with a good project, and they mostly kept the same squad. So for surviving would have been a massive achievement. I think Norwich are the best team to be relegated, because Norwich will have a better chance to come to the Premier League. They haven't spent excess. They've earned a good money from the Premier League TV money. And now Norwich will keep striving ahead. They have some great youngsters to build a squad. The only worry is players like Jamal Lewis, Cantwell, Emiliano, along with that you will have Cantwell, you have Max Ahrens, you have Ben Godfrey, then you have got good experienced player in Pookie, Krul. So I think if these players go, then it's a problem. But overall, there won't be any financial trouble, which is very good to see. Then I think we have to then go to Watford. With Watford, it's been very surprising. Sarr, Delafeu, you've got Will Hughes, Pereira, Doucouré, Troy Deeney, Joao Pedro. You've also got some great players in that whole squad. But the thing was, their defense was already very bad, and their high carry has it, like, they're very impatient. So at first they were very bad stage of the season. I remember they were like 6 to 7 points out of relegation, behind relegation zone. And then they appointed Nigel Pearson, a specialist, and he literally got them safe before the break. They beat the Premier League champions Liverpool, who were undefeated at that stage, 3-0. And it could have been 4, it could have been 5 if they wanted. They battered Liverpool, and they gave a pattern to other teams that how you can beat Liverpool, which style you have to follow to beat Liverpool. This was the thing that Watford did really well and should be respected. But after the break, everything just, like, you can see, went awry. Everything for them went bad. Nothing went good for Watford. And then the worst decision I'll ever see in my life was, like, who is going to sack a manager? Just two matches were left. Or literally, you can say just 1 week of the season was left, and they decided to sack a manager. Like, in what? Like, in what thinking you thought to sack a manager when you have 2 matches in hand, and that are against City and Arsenal, and they were relegated? With Watford, I think they won't be coming back next season. They won't be coming back. They have a big rebuild on their way. Then we go to Bournemouth. I think Bournemouth are everyone's favorite team for the story they have. Not for me, because Bournemouth have a fantastic form against Chelsea, and it was guaranteed 4 points when it was Bournemouth versus Chelsea. We already lost to them this season and drew 2-2. But to be honest, if we take that my side of Chelsea fan away, I was very impressed with the way they came up to the Premier League. They stayed for 4 years. It was a fantastic story from where they came up. But the thing was, you just can't take that into account. They've come here, they've spent some big money, especially the money that they spent on Jordan Ibe, Solanke, which has absolutely not worked well for them. And to be honest, they've only themselves to blame. In the end, they showed a good form. They had a great victory, 4-1 against Leicester, 3-1 against Everton. But then they lost at home to Southampton, 1-3. You can't do that. You just can't do that. And I just wish, I don't know how will they come back. I just don't know. Championship is a very hard league. It's not an easy league to come back. And we should all know that it's not an easy league to come back. And then we move on towards Aston Villa. Now, Aston Villa spent massive, massive, massive money. Now, this does not guarantee they were going to be in top 10, top 11. But this also, we never expected them to come to relegation zone on the last day. This is a big point for Aston Villa to open themselves up. Like, you've spent so much money and still you relied on Grealish to save you. If not for Grealish, they're not surviving. They are not surviving. So it's good for Aston Villa to survive, because I can see one thing. If Aston Villa were relegated, it could have been the biggest disaster for them. But now, they are there. And it's good. Let's see what they do next year. Then we go to West Ham. Now with West Ham, you just can't predict them. They ended the season with battering Chelsea, beating Norwich 4-0, and then drawing at Old Trafford. Like, this showed what capability they have. And before the break, they literally got something out at Anfield until the last two late goals by Liverpool, like always. So this team has a lot of ability, but then either they become complacent or I don't know what goes on, but they don't do well. And with the money that West Ham has put, they should be in the top half and not competing for relegation battle. Then we move on to Brighton. Now Brighton, for me, when they started the season, I was surprised to not see Glenn Murray. Glenn Murray was the most important player of the season. Yet they got him. He got out because Graham Potter preferred a passing style of football. But I think it worked really well. I enjoyed watching Brighton. They survived in the end. Many people were saying that attacking football was not going to work with this team, but Graham Potter did a fantastic job. A great upcoming manager. It's so good to see such young managers doing so well in the league. Then we move up to Crystal Palace. Now Crystal Palace are a team who just form stability. You just cannot predict what Crystal Palace are going to do. Like, they started the season, before the break they were very close to Europa League spot, but after the break they've lost mostly all of their matches. They were on a 4-match losing streak at the end of the season. Now that's pathetic, but in the end they survived. That's their goal. They never try to go over their goal, they never try to go underachieve. They just achieve their objectives and then everything is over. Then we move on towards another fantastic team above Crystal Palace. One was Everton and another was, I'm really sorry, I just have to check here, Newcastle. Now, Newcastle had a fantastic season, again, I will say. Like, I also remember when Steve Bruce was appointed, I will say, I was laughing. I was feeling for Newcastle fans because I thought that sacking Rafael Benitez is a very, very bad decision. He was not sacking, he left because he was not seeing ambition. And we all were laughing. But credit where it's due, Steve Bruce has done a fantastic, fantastic job. The way he has got the squad going, they were never in danger of relegation. At one stage they were, before the United win, where Matty Longstaff scored a fantastic goal. After that, it's been a simple ride. They have been fantastic this season and nothing but respect for me, for Steve Bruce. Then we go on to Everton, and this is one of the worst run clubs I've seen. They have a net spend of 275 million in last some years. That's 142 million more than Chelsea. And these are the stats that Amazon Prime put on their football page on Twitter. Now, I'm not fully sure they're correct, but I'm just giving you a certain data. And this was where the problem was. How can your club be so behind after their spending? But there's always light at the end of the tunnel. Can Carlo Ancelotti be that? We'll find out next season. Then we move on to Southampton. You just think as a fan, your team is going to lose 9-0. You're either going to cry, you're going to lose hope, you will have no positivity left. Just feel, I remember when we lost 6-0 to Man City. It felt deflated. We were done. I was shattered. I thought my team will never come up again. Will never become the Chelsea that they were. Just think, what will a Southampton fans thought? Southampton board will have easily clicked on the button, sack him. But they kept him. And what happened has to be the story of the season. Southampton, since that, they beat Chelsea, they got Rod United, they beat City, and they comfortably finished at 11. This is the team, remember, next season will be surprising all of you. Hasan Hüttl is a very, very good manager, and put some respect on these managers. Number 10. Now, number 10 again is Burnley. Burnley were just 5 points behind 6th place. This showed how tight competition was. Since Burnley have come up in the league, they've gone to Europa League qualifying stage at one season. Next season, they comfortably survived. This season, they got the Europa League. They nearly got the Europa League. They were fantastic. What Sean Dyche has done with minimal spend. I don't care you all say he plays defensive football in this lot. To do what he has done is not easy. It's one of the most difficult tasks. Nothing but respect for my side from Sean Dyche. Then we go towards the number 9 position. And number 9 position was Sheffield United. Now, I'm really sorry. I first thought Sheffield United might be in the top 8, but they were at 9th. Now, Sheffield had a very different season. When the break got over, Sheffield was just 5 points behind Chelsea with a game in hand against Aston Villa. We have to be honest, they should have won. Their goal should have been allowed to stand. So, we thought they had the best chance to get the Champions League position. But in the end, since the break, they've only taken 11 points from 10 matches. And they've only got 3 wins, which has been against Chelsea 3-0, Tottenham 3-1, Wolves 1-0. So this shows how after the break it never went well, but still the capability this squad has in them. It's been a fantastic story. This shows you when you have a process, when you have a manager, it's not just about name, it's about the process they undertake. And fantastic work to Chris Wilder for the work he has done. Then we move on to 8th and Arsenal. Now, Arsenal is a very big club. To be in number 8th position is an absolute disgrace. Absolute disgrace. But let's analyze it differently. Because if you start analyzing Arsenal's season, you will think that I am saying Arteta has not done well. No. I am talking about since the Emery part. After the destruction by Chelsea in the Europa League final, which they should have won. The Crystal Palace loss last year. The Brighton draw, where they should have got the top 4. It never worked well. If you play Torreira as a number 10, you're already going to get on fans' bad side. The way he handled the Xhaka booing situation, it was not working well. And then Freddie Ljungberg work, it never worked well again. But since Mikel Arteta has come here, even I'm jealous, he has done a fantastic job. What he has done different is, it's just not about points tally. It's about the mentality. Arsenal used to go with big away grounds and they used to give up. They went at City. Now, you all people will go and see the loss to City 3-0, but no. It was David Luiz's disaster that cost them. Till then, they were doing a fantastic work. After that also, many Arsenal fans thought that could be David Luiz's last game. But Arteta again handled it well. At Chelsea, even after the red card, they drew, they beat United, City, and then the way he's changed the tactics, I thought he's going to play tippy-tappa football. But the guy changed it. He played 3-5-2. The way he made Mustafi look like world-class defender. Fantastic work. And now they've got Tierney, they've got Bellerin, Saliba, Gabriel coming up. If they can get a Partey or Hakim Ziyech, Arsenal are through next season. Arteta is building something up there. Then we move on to Wolves. Now Wolves are only themselves to blame. They were just denied by goal difference. They put a fantastic run in Europa League where they were knocked out by Sevilla. But in the Premier League, in the last match they lost to Chelsea. Before that, they conceded a 94th minute goal against Burnley to draw. And then they lost to Sheffield by a 93rd minute goal. Wolves should have at least got a Europa League. Let alone a Champions League place. They have only themselves to blame. But overall, they had a very good season. That 2 wins over Man City will always be remembered fondly by the Wolves fan. Now, we move on to top 6 and Tottenham. Now, Tottenham had an absolute disaster. I don't know why Pochettino was sacked. I never understood why he never got a backing. But I think since Jose came, it was going to be a hard task. At first, Jose did a fantastic work to get Tottenham where they are. Now, again, Tottenham have only themselves to blame. Tottenham, when both the times they played Chelsea, at first point, they were just 3 points behind Chelsea. And they had a better goal difference. And they had a home game. If they beat Chelsea, they are in the top 4. They lost 2-0. Then at Stamford Bridge, even if they had injuries, we had injuries. And I think they were just like 2 points behind us. But we won. And Tottenham again lost. And then they gave up. But I think next season Jose will do better. When he will have more time. So let's say we have to see how it does with the team where he won't get the backing. Now we move on to number 5, Leicester. Now Leicester, see, if we analyze them at the end of the season, we all are going to say, sack Rodgers. We have to analyze it properly. I will never expected Leicester to be in the top 6. If you ask me in August, Leicester are going to be top 6, I would have laughed at you. So they've done a fantastic job. But on the other hand, you just can't keep using this thing. Oh, they got the top 4. They got the top 5. What's the problem? They overachieved. The way they ended the season is unacceptable. They literally ended the season with like 25 points from the last 22 matches. That's a disgrace. That's a disgrace. And they've only themselves to blame, because I don't think they will ever get a better chance to get top 4. Especially when they lose their main players. But overall, this club will keep building and keep striving ahead. And I wish them best of luck. A beautiful club. They play some beautiful football. Number 4, we go to Chelsea. Now, I'm a Chelsea fan. When Eden Hazard went, it was literally crying mood. Like, who we had in the attack? Sky Sports put Barkley as a number 1 player. And then you had players like Pogba, players like Sergio Aguero, players like Salah. That showed a difference. So in that point, we overachieved. Rival fans might say anything, but we did fantastic work. But we also have to remember some other things as well. First of all, this is the first season where 66 points are going to be enough for top 4. So we have well done to our rivals too, that you allowed us to be up. Because Chelsea, 66 points doesn't mean a great season. Number second, there were some defeats where it showed that the manager is still inexperienced, manager is still learning, and the team is still very young. The defeats to Southampton, West Ham, Bournemouth, defeat to Everton away, these were not good defeats. You cannot defend that. Everton were coming into it in an absolute bad form, and Chelsea were battered. So you can't defend these type of defeats. Defeats to Newcastle, draw to Brighton at home, loses to West Ham and Sheffield. But in the end, they got the job done. Chelsea knew they were going to have a tough season. They just wanted by hook and crook to get top 4. They did it. For Arsenal, FA Cup win is fantastic, because it shows what Arteta is capable of. For Chelsea, it's disappointing to lose a final, but they did their job in the season. And now, with the signings they are going, this Champions League has helped them a lot to earn that money and reinvest them towards signing. Chelsea won the Europa League last season, and Chelsea earned 35 million. This season, we have reached around the 16th of Champions League and have earned around 80 million. That shows the difference the Champions League makes. Now we move on to third United. Same like Chelsea. At first, I will again say United did spend money in the summer. They did spend money in the summer. But also, context is important. Since the season started, Pogba got injured, Martial got injured, and the attack that they have, they had, I think, Lingard, Pereira, Martial when he was fit, Rashford, James. This shows you where the problem was. And their biggest mistake was not signing Bruno Fernandes in August like Edward Wood does. But in the end, their objective was also to get top 4, and when every player was back fully fit, you have to say, and I am saying as unbiasedly as possible, after the lockdown, they were one of the best sides in the league. They were one of the best sides in the league, and they played really well. Bruno Fernandes, Paul Pogba, Mason Greenwood, Marcus Rashford, Anthony Martial, that's a beautiful attack. They just need to add some depth and one or two more world-class players to compete for the title. Then we move on to second City. Now with City, people will say they won the title 2 times in a row. Why are you being so critical? But see, they have literally splashed 200 to 300 million on fullbacks. They have spent 200 to 300 million on fullbacks. That's massive money. And they never perform well in the Champions League. People keep saying it's about performances. But see, getting knocked out by Monaco, getting knocked out by Liverpool side who were under progress, had no Alisson at that time. No Fabinho, and you lost to them very easily. Then Tottenham, a side which is not even, I will say, they are like 10 times behind you in spending. You have spent a billion and they have not even spent like 300 to 400 million, and you lost to them. And this year you lost to Lyon. Like, you can't defend that. And then Premier League is a shout and you defend it such badly. You lost to Norwich when they had mostly all the players injured. 2 losses to Wolves. It was a disgraceful defensive title. But next season, I think Pep Guardiola has to do better. Because in Champions League, they just can't do anything to save their lives. So league is a chance, and I think Pep Guardiola is a manager who bounces back. And now we move on to number 1, Liverpool. 30 years wait. 30 years agony. 5 years agony of what happened at Anfield when Steven Gerrard slipped. And what happened to Crystal Palace 3-3 draw. But since Jurgen Klopp has come with minimal resources, we have to be real, nobody of the rival fans, even me, would have thought Liverpool will come this far when Jurgen Klopp was appointed. This guy was taunted Oh, he lost 3 finals. He did nothing. Oh, Jurgen Klopp finished 8th. What happened? He reached the Champions League final in 17 in the season when he had no Fabinho. He had Van Dijk for a half season. And he had no Alisson. Next season, he got a 97 points and he won the Champions League. This season, they won the league with 99 points. What a team. What a performance. Only thing is, how much will they add next season to be competitive? I think this really shows what Premier League review is. That next year, it's going to be more hard. Chelsea are stronger. Arsenal are stronger. United, if they add Sancho, will get stronger. City are signing players. How much stronger Liverpool and Tottenham are going to get? This brings the Premier League review to an end. I really wish you guys would have enjoyed it. Please leave your feedbacks below and leave your Premier League feedback below in the comment section. It was a great pleasure to discuss my